Welcome today. I do hope that you're doing fine. I am well, and today we want to look at topic two, of which we are looking at medical parasitology. And remember, we say that we have three main branches of medical parasitology, and we're winding up the last topic. And we said we do have medical parasitology, we have helminthology, and we have entomology. So today we are beginning with medical protozoology, whereby you'll find that we are basically focusing on protozoa. That is why there's that name, protozoology. So we are basically focusing on protozoa, which are the, in singular, we call it protozoan. And this is actually a Greek word. This protozoa word has been picked from a Greek word, protos and zoon, meaning first animal. And these are members of the eukaryotic protist. I believe you have some little basic background of your biology. So they may have distinguished from other eukaryotic protists by their ability to move at some stage of their life cycle and by their lack of cell wall. So they don't have a cell wall and they have an ability to move at some stage of their life cycle. Now, what are the learning objectives of this course today? Basically, by the end of this lesson, you should be able to discuss the classification of medically important protozoa. Also, you should be able to discuss the pathogenesis and clinical aspects of infections. That is how the etiology occurs of these diseases related to this microorganism. And the clinical aspects of infection, meaning you need to describe the symptoms, you know, the signs and symptoms and how we can manage. You should also be able to describe the general epidemiological aspect and transmission patterns of disease caused by protozoa. I would also expect that by the end of this lesson, you should be able to identify the methods and procedures of laboratory protozoa. Also, you need to be able to describe or discuss treatment options for protozoan infection and also implement the preventive and control measures protozoan infection. Now, we have it that protozoa are usually found in all moist habitats. All moist habitats, that is where they occur. They're all found where? In all moist habitats. So that tells you that in places where we have a lot of moisture, a lot of water content, we are likely to have protozoa present in such environments. So they are common in the sea, in soil, and also in fresh water. The sea, in soil, and in fresh water. So you'll find that people who go swimming in the seas, in the rivers, are likely to be at risk. As we dig, you know, as we farm, as we come in contact with soil, we are likely to be at risk with protozoa. And also, we are staying in fresh water. Remember that most of our water is fresh water. So as we come in contact with this fresh water, as we wash our hands, as we drink it, you know, as we bathe, we are likely to come into contact with this protozoa. So these organisms occur generally as a single cell. And we already say that we it from other cells because it doesn't have a cell wall and it has that ability to move at some stage within its life cycle. So some of the types of protozoa are resistant cysts. They have a stage where they become resistant to non-motile and they're able to survive in adverse environmental conditions such as desiccation, low nutrient supply, and even aerobiosis, whereby there is no air, they can be able to survive. Or they have no nutrient or enough, they can still be able to survive. So examples of protozoa like the soil amoeba, yeah, also have Naegleria, which is a resistant cyst in dry weather, and also you have Naegleria amoeba in moist soil and becomes flagellated when flooded with water. Now, its morphology. Remember, we say that when we talk about these medically important parasites or parasitology, We are likely to delve into several aspects, of which we said we look at morphology, geographical distribution. We said we'll also look at its life cycle. We shall look at the host-parasite relationship. And also, in terms of laboratory diagnosis, how it's diagnosed, and eventually, maybe now, the other modes of treatment and such like. So about its morphology, and morphology said it's about size and shape. Protozoa are predominantly microscopic, ranging in size from 2 to more than 100 millimeters. Morphologically, they are within a mass of protoplasm consisting of a true membrane, bound nucleus, and cytoplasm. And the nucleus contains clamped or dispersed chromatin and central nucleolus or karyosome, which are useful structures to distinguish protozoa species from one another based on the shape, size, and distribution of these structures. So basically, we are saying that they're quite microscopic, they're primarily microscopic. So they can only be identified when we check them out in a microscope, whether it's light or electronic microscope. The protozoa have some importance, whereby they serve as an important link in the food chain and ecological balance of many communities in wetland and aquatic environments, basically found in the sea, soil, and freshwater. There are also important biological sewage treatment, which involves both anaerobic digestion and or aeration. And in addition, protozoa are important laboratory organisms and researchers by which their sexual reproduction enables clones to be established with the same genetic makeup. These are useful in the study of cell cycles, nucleic acid biosynthesis during evolution. So the major medical concern about the protozoa that ubiquitous areas, including the human alimentary canal. Remember, the alimentary canal or the digestive system, it's quite wet from the mouth, it's watery. And as we move to the top, the acid by several fluids within the system to keep it moist and to keep the food moving. So it means that we are prone to protozoa, given that as human beings, we have those moist areas, especially in the canal. So from an ecological standpoint, protozoa are divided into free living forms and symbiotic forms. And some of the symbiotic forms are parasitic and may cause disease. So like amoeba, of course, the entamoeba histolytica usually is an example in human beings, which can exactly the intestinal tract of the human beings. It is likely to invade tissues and produce diseases. So the majority of ciliates are free living and seldom parasite humans. So in terms of reproduction, as a general rule, usually that protozoa multiply by sexual reproduction. This is not to say that sexual processes are absent in the protozoa. Some parasitic forms may have a sexual phase in one host and a sexual phase in another host. About its transmission, in most parasitic protozoa, the development stages are transmitted from one host to another within a cyst, and the reproduction process is also related to the formation of the cyst. And a sexual reproduction of some cysts, as we shall look at them later, is associated with formation and sexual reproduction of protozoa, invariably results in a cyst. Pathogenic protozoa can spread from one infected person to another. Basically, fecal transmission, where we have transmission from food and water. Look here, fecal oral transmission basically means fecal is oral, feces. From the word feces, we get the word fecal. So, assuming that someone has gone to the bathroom or toilet, after doing whatever he or she has done there, assuming maybe this is a food vendor, he or she comes from there, doesn't wash hands. So it means probably the fingers. So as he or she comes and handles food, probably salad, probably just food, you know, serving food, giving you a spoon, you know, serving food, giving you a spoon and bringing to you. Yes, you wash your hands. But at this point, you handle this food that was touched by this person, But likely, maybe I remember eating some food with your fingers, maybe like chicken or something that needs you maybe to touch a fish or something that will need to use your fingers to eat. Of course, you use the spoon, the forks, and the knives. But then sometimes you find people kind of naturally using their fingers. So as you use that, you find that you get the food put in your mouth. It's called fecal oral. Oral is mouth, the oral cavity mouth. Yeah. So from the feces that this person had on his fingers or her fingers, they came to the food you are consuming, if they're salads or fruits, or on the spoon that you got, or the glass, and handle it and touch your food, you get it into your system, and then it easily get infected. Yeah, so we're saying that we have three major ways. The first one we said is the fecal oral transmission. The second one is sexual intercourse, and the other one is insect bit inoculums or rubbing infection surfaces on the site of the bite. Now, how about its pathogenesis? Here we find that prostaglandins are virtually always acquired from exogenous source, and as such, they have evolved numerous ways to enter the body of the human host. Factors that are important for pathogenesis include attachment to the host tissue, followed by replication to establish colonization, then toxic produces the parasitic protozoa, and also shedding of antigenic expression to evade immune response and inactivate host diseases. So these we find generally the anti-protozoa agents usually target the relatively rapidly proliferating young mammals of the parasites, and most commonly these agents usually target the source-specific metabolic pathways unique to the protozoan site. Now, usually we have classification for protozoa. And the protozoa may call implants based on their fluid and locomotive system. So the one we have fibers, and most of these are historica. We have the common vaginalis. Remember, we talked about the ability of these diseases being specific on. Trichomonas, the analysis basically through sexual contact, and we have Trypanosoma species, Leishmania, and we have Leophora, Orbal, and Tibium coli. Then we have Coccidia as the third classification, and here we have Cryptosporidium parvum, Toxoplasma gondii, and also Plasmodium species. Remember, these Plasmodium species are the malaria species. That's why now we see other ways to transmit through what? Insects, insect bite, inoculums, or rubbing, infected insect feces on the side of the bite. So, protozoan pathogens will be transmitted to the location of the body where the most frequently caused disease. So, in terms of location, we have like the intestinal tract, whereby basically there, whatever the intestinal tract, that is from the mouth, esophagus, stomach, small intestines, large intestines, rectum, then anus. So this intestinal tract, amoeba, Histolytica, Caelia, Lamblia, Rhizoidea, Lantidium, coli, Ispropera, bellae, and Cyclophora chitinensis. So this is that it brings out giardiasis, balanitidiasis, isoporosis, cyclosporiasis, and also have cryptosporidiasis. Then we have the ones that will affect the urogenital tract, the ones that we talked about sexual contact, like trichomonas, mostly to bring about trichomoniasis. Also have that in the blood tissue, have some Plasmodium species, like Toxoplasma, Trypanosoma species, Leishmania species, Acanthamoeba species, Babesia microti, Naegleria species, and then we bring about malaria, toxoplasmosis, trypanosomiasis. We also bring about leishmaniasis, amoebic meningoencephalitis, amoebic encephalitis and babesiosis. Influences are likely to affect the meninges. Meninges are really mostly the spinal cord, the meninges, whereby it brings about meningitis. So that's basically the information that we need to understand about protozoa, not complicated. The basic thing that we've looked at is that we've been able to look at its occurrence, where protozoa occur, its morphology. We've looked at the importance of protozoa, whereby we say that it's usually important because it forms an important link in the food chain and the ecological balance within communities in wetland and aquatic environments. They're usually able to bring about diseases because, especially human beings, they're present within the human alimentary canal. And we mentioned about the production, especially through, they multiply through asexual reproduction. We talk about the transmission, we say have three major routes of transmission. They transmit through sexual intercourse, through what's called oral transmission, and also through insect bites. We've talked about the pathogenesis, so you say that there could be a protozoa that virtually is acquired from a source, and with such they have evolved numerous in the body of the human host, and factors that are important for pathogenesis usually include attachment to the host's tissue to establish colonization. Also, you have toxic products, parasitic protozoa, and also shifting pathogenic elevate the immune response and elevate the host defenses. So above the agents, we've talked basically about the antiprotozoal agents that target relatively the rapidly proliferating young brain cells. So basically that is like the target of treatment. So when you get treated, whoever is treating you, the doctor, has to send you to the lab for it to verify whether whatever condition you have or if from the protozoa have affected any part of your body in terms of the intestinal tract, the urogenital tract, or blood and tissue. So remember that you can classify diseases depending on the location. You can also just talk about them in terms of their morphology and locomotive system. So that is what we've covered today, and I do believe that we've got any information about the protozoa. If you have any query on this, when you meet in our class, kindly feel free to ask. I'll be available. I'm also still available on phone. I'm available through my official address of the university. So kindly feel free to contact me should you have any issue concerning this course. So I do hope that we shall interact more. Have a nice time.